Hi everyone, my name is Scientist Betty and I'm the host of a show called Spotlight with Scientists in School. On this show, I get to interview some pretty amazing scientists. I've had conversations with an ice cream scientist, a kid inventor, a bee researcher, and today we're going to chat with scientist Heather. We're going to join her on an outdoor adventure as she teaches us all about water. Hi, Scientist Heather.
Hi, Scientist Betty.
Welcome to the show. Tell me, Heather, why do you love science?
So I've always been very curious, and especially about nature. And if I was on a walk and I would see an interesting animal, I would want to learn more about it. And science would give me those answers.
And what are we going to be doing today?
So today we're going to be looking at animals and plants that live in the water. And we know that water is important for all living things, but some need it to breathe, to lay eggs, or to provide shelter. And I'm hoping we may be able to see some amphibians and some aquatic invertebrates. And I'll be talking about those later.
So do we need any special tools today?
So we're definitely going to need our senses. We're going to need our eyes and our ears. But if we're going to study an aquatic environment and the animals there, we're going to need a net to catch things. And we're also going to need waders if I'm going to get right in the water and up close.
Sounds great. We'll meet you outside.
See you soon.
Bye.
So that sound is music to my ears. After a really long, cold winter, the temperatures have finally gone up, the ice has melted, and this marsh is providing a beautiful habitat for a large group of amphibians. And those amphibians have long jumping legs, they have a long tongue they can stick out to catch insects and other invertebrates. And if you were thinking frogs, you were correct. So this habitat is perfect for our frogs. They have to have water to be able to breed. Their eggs are a jelly-like mass, they have to stay wet, and their tadpoles have gills, so they have to live in the water. Right now behind me I can hear a bunch of different frogs that are all calling. I can hear three different types of frogs. There is a wood frog, and their sound sounds a bit like a chicken clucking, kind of a chuck 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 sound, so you can listen for that. And there are also spring peepers, which is a really loud frog that you can hear making the peep, peep, peep sound. They're actually the smallest of the frogs, small tree frog, and they're very secretive. They're hard to catch and hard to see. And the third frog is called a boreal chorus frog. And their call sounds like somebody running their fingers over the tines of a comb. Kind of a grrr, grrr, that's what they sound like.
Here you can hear one of our boreal chorus frogs. You can really hear that sounding like somebody rubbing their thumb over the tines of a comb. What a great sound. And this male doesn't seem to be too bothered at all by us taping him in the pond. Here's another beautiful wood frog. You can get a good look at those back legs that are specialized for jumping. Big, big muscles allow them to jump and swim. They have webbed toes that allow them to go quickly through the water.
So I managed to catch one of our wood frogs, and you can see, I'm gonna bring him closer so you can see him. He's got that super slimy skin that I was telling you about, and it has to stay wet most of the time because they actually breathe a little bit through their skin. This one is a very dark frog, wood frog. Wood frogs can vary in color between very light brown to almost black and sometimes even greenish. They do have a little mask that they, oh, he's calling. Not very happy with me. They do have a little dark mask around their eye. This one's a bit dark, so it's hard to see the mask, but that tells us that it's a wood frog. And so I'm not going to keep him out of the water for very long because, again, his skin will dry up and then he won't be able to breathe as well. So I just wanted to give you a little look, and then we're going to put him back in the water and hopefully he's going to find a mate soon. So some people ask me, why are frogs important? Well, they're super important for us to understand, and here's why. They're a very important part of the food chain in a marsh. They provide food for animals like herons, raccoons, snakes, and they actually keep the population of invertebrates in the pond down as well. Things like crustacean and aquatic insects, they eat those. That's one reason. The other reason is that frogs have a very thin skin, as I mentioned, and they can actually absorb toxins very easily through that skin. And so they are what we call a bioindicator in a marsh to tell us whether the marsh is healthy or not, because they are one of the first animals that would be able to absorb those toxins and tell us if the water is polluted. So scientists do studies in wetland areas to see the number of frogs that are there, and that tells them whether the area is healthy or not.
Here's a wood frog, and just in front of it, you can see there's a little fisher spider. It's a spider that lives in the water that skates across the top of the water, and that would actually be something a wood frog might eat. Oh, there he goes. So here we have some wood frog eggs. You can see they're jelly-like masses with thousands and thousands of eggs in them. They are explosive breeders, meaning that they lay thousands of eggs in a short period of time. And here we have a leech who has already found this mass of eggs and is helping himself to a tasty snack. So that's why they lay so many eggs, because there will be predators that will come along and eat the eggs. And so they want at least some of them to hatch out as tadpoles.
So this is a marsh that I'm standing at here, and it's defined as an area, a wetland, that has many different types of vegetation in it. Compared to a swamp, that's defined as a wetland that has mostly trees and woody plants in it. A fen and a bog are two more types of wetlands, and those wetlands have varying amounts of acidity, so whether they are acidic like vinegar or basic like baking soda. So this marsh area has lots of different types of vegetation. I'm trying to talk over the frogs, they're so loud. Here's one of the types of vegetation that's very common in this marsh, and it's a cattail. And the vegetation in the swamp provides shelter for animals to hide in to protect themselves from predators, as well as lots and lots of food. So frogs love this type of marsh because it gives them lots of area to hide from predators. Their tadpoles can weave in and around and hide. And they also provide lots and lots of food. Cattails have lots of roots at the bottom that all different types of animals actually feed on, including muskrats, one of our mammals that would live in a wetland area. And the top part provides an area that insects can hide in, as well as fluffy parts that birds can use to make their nests. So now I'm in a swamp. And we know it's a swamp because the primary vegetation here are trees and woody plants. This area fills up with water every spring as the snow melts and the rain falls. It becomes a beautiful wetland for all kinds of animals. You can hear mallard ducks are making some sound. And it's also a fantastic place to catch invertebrates. These are animals without backbones. And so I'm going to do some dip netting and see if I can find anything in the water. So from my dip netting of the water, I managed to find a whole bunch of creatures. So we've got three or four different ones that I can see in here. The beautiful orange colored creatures that look like they have waves of legs moving are fairy shrimp. They're a crustacean. They have 13 sets of legs, and they are a very important part of the food chain for fish and other small invertebrates. And they actually can be bred as fish food for people who have aquariums. Our little worm-like creatures that look like they're twirling back and forth are mosquito larvae. So this area that we're in right now will be full of adult mosquitoes in about a month or so, once those larvae hatch into adults.
And the mosquitoes actually breathe air. The mosquito larvae breathe air. They have a little small opening on their back end of their abdomen. And that's why they hang upside down in the water most of the time. You can see some of them doing that right now. And they actually breathe air. So they can live in water that sits very still and has very little bit of oxygen in it because they breathe air. And then the third creature I can see in here is one of my favorites. It's a caddisfly larva. We have two or three of them, and they are a larva that actually makes a little house for themselves. So this one has made a house for itself out of little pieces of sticks. They can use even pieces of gravel or hollow reeds, and they put their bodies inside there and to protect them from predators, and then they can actually move around and stay quite safe while they're feeding in the wetlands. So all of these invertebrates would be important food for fish and other creatures in this area. And they are also really cool to look at.
So here we have a pair of mallards, and they are a beautiful duck, and we can tell the difference between the male and the female because of their coloring. The males have a beautiful green head, whereas the females are much duller brown, and that's so that they can hide when they are sitting on the nest and camouflage from predators.
So I'm on the way to a pond to see what kind of animals that I can see there. And I found some signs that some animals have been nearby. Down here we have some sticks and some trees that have been chewed by a large mammal with very large teeth that keep growing, continuously grow, and they have to continuously chew to keep those teeth going down to the right length. If you guessed beaver, you are correct. We're gonna go on our way and see what we can find.
So there is evidence that beavers have been at this pond, and they have been very, very busy around this area, chewing on logs, taking the bark off of trees, and using those logs to make a lodge or to make a dam. And beavers can actually change the landscape by changing the water levels in different areas, which changes the environment significantly. So we found an animal in the pond. We found a painted turtle sitting out on the log, warming his body in the sun. He's a reptile, so he can't control his temperature, body temperature. So he's warming up so that he can go for a swim later.
So here's some major evidence that a beaver has been at work, gnawing on this tree with those teeth I was telling you about that never stop growing. And here I've got a skull to show you what those teeth look like. They have special incisors that actually go outside of their lip, and there's a reason for that. It's so that they can chew underwater without getting water in their mouth. They also have some other adaptations to allow them to swim. They have ears and nostrils that close shut. They have a small membrane that goes over their eyes when they're swimming, almost like goggles. And of course, that beautiful tail that acts as a rudder to help them steer through the water. So I wanted to thank you so much for joining me on my exploration of wetlands today. I hope that you enjoyed learning about water and what animals depend on water and live on water. And I hope that you will continue exploring wetlands in your neighborhood as well. So on behalf of scientists in school, thank you so much for joining me.